And we put this weight on people that they have to have everything right and perfect, and they don't. We put this weight on people saying that you're the reason for your mental illness, you're the reason for your sickness, and you're not. And God's mindset is just the power of mindset, the power of Christ, who came to teach us the renewing of your thoughts, right? And we have an episode coming out really soon with Todd Vick that's literally all about this, is the renewing of your mind. It's a scientific principle. It's a spiritual principle. It's in the Bible. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Well, a lot of the principles Jesus taught weren't about heaven. They were about heaven on earth. And that's why we've got to spend so much more time focused on life.
And that's where the conversation has to start happening about mental health and mental illnesses and depression and suicidal tendencies and all these things, without the judgment, without the just hatred. And if people are hurting, you know, one of the biggest things that I feel that the church needs to, I guess, I don't know if own up to is the correct term, because that sounds so negative. But a couple weeks ago, I actually wrote a blog post about how sometimes there is an alternative to church. You know, sometimes mental health isn't a spiritual thing. Sometimes the depression and suicidal tendencies and thoughts aren't because we lack prayer or a lack of community or a lack of reading the Bible. Sometimes it's deeper, and most of the times it's a lot deeper and more psychological and more scientific than just, oh, I should be praying. Because a lot of these people are praying. A lot of these people are reading the Bible and actively going to church and being around communities of people, but they're hurting and they have specific lies, you know, that they're being told or that they feel. And a lot of times church leaders and religion push the, well, you should be praying more, or do you have any unforgiven sin, or are you reading your Bible, do you actively go to church? Like I said, a lot of times they are doing those things, but they still have these issues. And you know, I wrote a blog post a couple of weeks ago about sometimes you need an alternative. You know, church pastors and leadership most of the time are not trained, do not have the education and the background to fully help people with their mindset, fully help people with their mental health and mental illnesses. Mm-hmm. Yes, I believe that spirituality is strong. I do believe in the power of prayer. I do believe in surrounding yourself with people who love you. And I do believe that God can heal and that God is good. And all of those things are important and necessary and powerful. I believe all of that. But I also believe that science and medicine or education or other practices are equally, and I feel sometimes more important than it just if you're reading your Bible. And there are a lot of things that pastors are not trained to help with. Pastors are trained for the most part to help with the spiritual aspect. And some of them may be trained educationally to handle mental health. But that's why you have pastors, and you also have therapists, you also have psychologists, you also have doctors, people who are trained for these things. Mm-hmm. And I know one of the biggest pressures of people who are going through depression are, well, I'm not praying enough, or I need to read my Bible, or I just really need to have more faith. But there's something, so I don't believe that there's something more powerful than faith, but I do believe that there are things that are equal to faith. And the reason why I say that is because I remember my senior year of high school. It was on April Fool's Day. We're about to graduate. And there was this kid that I wasn't super close to, but I interacted with him several times, had classes with him. You know, everybody loved him. He was this good Southern country boy, you know, Christian, super sweet, super loving, always there for other people, super active in his church. And on April Fool's Day, a month before we were supposed to graduate, he took his own life. And nobody would have ever thought that he was capable of that, or that he had these thoughts, because he was so loving. Because he was, you know, we had an active prayer circle that we had in high school that we did every Wednesday at lunchtime. Oftentimes he led this prayer circle, and he still took his own life. There were more things that he was dealing with than just going to church and being a good person and loving other people. And I really feel like if he had a therapist or a psychologist or a doctor or people who were trained educationally to also be taking care of him, as well as a pastor. I believe it's a balance of faith and spirituality, but a lot of times we focus too much on the faith part.
Well, and that reminds me of, I believe it was Robin Williams who took his own life not too long ago. Yeah. It was a little while back now, but one of the things that Robin Williams had said, I'm not quoting this word for word, but it's something along the lines of, oftentimes those who show the most compassion or love or try to make people happy are the ones hurting themselves because they know what it's like to not have that. And so, like, it's something
they that compensate.
Hides, yeah, it hides in plain sight. And so that's kind of what, just to sum this up here, you have self-love and you have self-harm. Self-harm is more than suicide. Self-harm is more than cutting your wrists. Like, you know, that was a huge thing when we were growing up. I guess it's kind of had a bit of a resurgence recently. Self-harm is so much more than burning your skin or inflicting self-wounds. It's the mental abuse of, I'm not good enough, I'm not worthy.
The dirty rag mentality. And